the tissue itself can be compliant and help with that. And then the airways themselves can be open or not as open. And so the tissue itself, the ductwork itself presents its own impedance or obstruction. And so here's just another to continue that talk. I think this is interesting. Airway resistance is highest in the medium-sized bronchi of the conducting zone. And that's because you have all those off-ramps. So you start out with a big trachea and then a bronchus and then a lobar bronchus and then a segmental bronchus. And then you start having bronchioles where there's tons of branching. And that's where the turbulence really occurs because the air flow is resisted. It's not as open because of that. I think there's a card going around. Is this true? Mm-hmm. Then to be signed for Amanda. Then okay. So that's fine. And so then when you get down to this conducting zone and you get the respiratory zone and you get to this respiratory bronchial and the alveolar duct, it's quite open to the alveolar sac. So there's less airway obstruction there. Just based on ductwork, and so that medium area. And this is a neat curve of resistance goes up, and the amount of branching. And you see the highest resistance is in that conducting zone. And then the more you just get to where you're going, you have less branching. So that's kind of neat. So there's some built-in issue there. Then, what happens that's interesting is these medium-sized bronchi have smooth muscle, and those can be the source of bronchoconstriction. So, if you're bronchoconstricting a little bit in that highest area of airway resistance, you get a large reduction of airflow. And so pathologically, when somebody is bronchoconstricted, you make a big difference with a little bronchoconstriction. Therefore, a little bronchodilation can help a lot. And so that's why you're rescuing that situation. Lung compliance, to continue just about how much the lung will stretch, is about the tissue itself. And so compliance decreases when that tissue becomes less stretchy. And so fibrotic systems, a fibrotic process is coming from that, kind of from the outside in a sense. You've had long-term inflammation, and so fibrotic tissue healing, or if there is this, we call them restrictive lung diseases, where there has been kind of less stretchiness from the elastic, from the cartilage kind of side of it, the actual cartilage that's surrounding the alveoli. If you have an actual obstruction, of course, that's going to change that. Alveolar film changes, and so there are going to be some diseases that where you have more inflammation going on, and that film itself will change that. And then the thoracic cage can become less flexible. It certainly happens as we age. Or debility, if you are less mobile. So post-op, even for short amounts of time, you decrease gas exchange because you're just laying down. You're not vertical, not moving as much. You really have to encourage people to keep expanding their lungs. And this is something you'll be guiding people to do. And you know that even your posture itself does that. You know, when it decreases your expansion the more you are schlumpy. And so, one of the first things that they have you do when you come into classes is get into the anatomical position and open that airway up. And so when people get older and their bodies are tighter, less mobile, less flexible, that certainly goes to compliance or decreased compliance. So, you just keep moving. Lung elasticity. Elasticity is the ability of the tissues to recoil, not just stretch. Stretching is compliance, and recoiling is this elastic nature. So it has to go back. you can comply and bring in air, but you don't want it to go past a certain point, because that would be dangerous for tissue. And so on exhalation, these spaces need to decrease, and so that's part of that tissue movement, and that recoil is natural. Now, recoil is quite passive. The tissue wants to recoil. It's essential to expiration. But when you've lost lung wall and you've lost COPD or something like that, like emphysema, you don't have as much alveolar space and you don't have as much elasticity, you lose the ability to really get air out with a disease like that. Here's a picture of surface tension. I like this picture. Surface tension is one of those simple concepts, I think, or I should say a common concept that you've heard about. I like it in this way. And that when you have an interface between the fluid phase and an air phase, for example, when there's an interface across that surface between the two, the water molecules are drawn very tightly together and create this surface tension. Water has a high surface tension because water molecules, there's H2O, but then there's that hydrostatic or hydrogen sort of forces that pull molecules together, water molecules together. And they certainly, you see that at an interchange or surface with air, surface tension. So, the bubble. And so how can we disrupt that? If we can disrupt those molecules and keep them from forming that surface, increasing that surface tension, forming a surface tension, if we can disrupt that, then we decrease surface tension. And in an alveolus, think about this alveolus, this sphere, and there has to be water lining the sphere, but it has to be filled with air. It's a bit of a trick. So that natural surface tension is going to want to draw that little sphere together, bring it in. And so you want to kind of disrupt that so that we want it to draw in, but we don't want it to collapse. That's a trick that works beautifully all day long.
All night long.
And so surfactant is that thing that disrupts that surface tension of water. So surfactant reduces the surface tension of water, and it does that by actually intercalating into that water and making the surface tension go away, because you're disrupting the ability of those molecules to just get together. Like soap. That's all soap is doing. It's disrupting that surface tension so you can spread the water across the surface better. It is a lipoprotein. Decreases surface tension, prevents alveolar collapse. So there's energy required to overcome surface tension. If you reduce surface tension, you reduce the energy required. So that's cute. And those are our type 2 alveolar cells are making surfactant. And here's just a little glimpse into when is there insufficient surfactant in the innate. And as the baby gets, as the infant, this is not baby, it's a fetus. As it gets older, those cells become more and more active. So the closer to gestational age, the more active those cells are, the more surfactant is on board at birth. And so 50% of babies born at that 26 to 28 week age. And that's kind of that. Boy, that's really early, and are they going to make it past that? They're able to make it. 25% to 25% have. What am I trying to say? 50% in babies. What I'm trying to say is at 26 weeks, they're at about 50% of what would be the amount of surfactant. And so surfactant is just increasing at gestational age. It's a hard way I'm trying to say that. If with decreased surfactant, there is high heart rate, respiratory rate, cyanosis. And so that's one of the first things to get in there and do is use surfactant as a spray, positive pressure ventilation, which will just put more oxygen into the lungs and try to overcome that until the alveolar cells catch up. So that's one of the first things in a, what is premature baby. And the biggest deal, the more premature they are. Wow, I said all of that the hard way. You are welcome. It's a little challenge here on your afternoon post-spring break. Hosting now. Bring it. So what you guys need to know then is you know how somebody feels and how they look. And there are really actual ways of sort of measuring the actual movement of air, that is spirometry, measuring breath. You're going to order and or see lots of pulmonary function tests, PFTs, and those are really that indicator. And what we use them for is to say, where are you and are these drugs helping? And so you'll follow pulmonary function tests as a way of saying, am I doing enough? Because there are certain things that, okay, you might not be breathing really well, but it certainly goes to longevity of that lung health. And so all the time I feel like I hear people that I think, you have reactive airways disease. I think it's super underdiagnosed in adults. And you'll hear that breathing in people and just think, you know, that's not just trouble now. It's like that osteoporosis. You're building your bones. It's osteoporosis is a disease that shows up later in life that you started in your early life. I think it's a lot like that with respiratory. The respiratory system for sure is that the less disease, the better health all along, which is the most nebulous thing I could have possibly said. But the fact that if you have some inflammatory state going on, it is going to change that lung tissue for the long haul. And so you want to be able to say, well, are we getting this person breathing well? Because it's not just how they feel now, it's how they're going to feel later too, is what I'm trying to say. And so there are a lot of ways to do that. This little deal right here is an incentive spirometer. We always use these in rehab or post-op, or if they're just, they're in, you know, deconditioned. And they're not as ambulatory, not breathing as hard, not breathing as deep. And you give them this thing, and they're supposed to try to get the little level up. You have your OCD people, they're huffing into that thing, trying to get that little beat up high. But you're supposed to encourage incentive spirometry every couple of hours. The more, the earlier and the more deeply you breathe goes to longevity of lung health and recuperation. And that's from a knee surgery, much less if it was something, a respiratory illness. So the more you can get somebody moving and breathing deeply, it goes to their lung health. And so that's one of those things. And then you can also actually just get measurements from from whatever measuring device is being used, from these handheld digital ones to something that's a bigger apparatus that's really measuring all the air going in and out. So it's a measure of effort, and it goes to function, obviously. So here are some of the volumes that you need to know for spirometry and for pulmonary function tests and so forth. And so this same picture I'm going to have slide after slide after slide so that we can see all of it. So here's breathing, this normal little eupnea or tidal volume, quiet eupnea. Normal breathing is this just in and out. You can certainly have a forced inhalation and a forced exhalation, which would be in excess of that tidal breathing. And there's going to be some air always remaining in the lungs. We don't completely exhale all the air, or we would never get over the energy required to fill that lung again. So you always have some residual there. And so that's the whole amount of lung volume. So we divide it into all these pieces. TV, tidal volume, quiet breathing in and out. What is that amount? And you look at this picture, it's about a half a liter. That doesn't seem like very much. Nobody has a Coke can here. How much is that? Is that a liter? That's really fancy.
Here's a liter.
Yeah, okay, half of that is how much air we're moving. And we're keeping all of our electron transport chains going with it. That's really kind of fancy.
No.
You're like a real housewife of PA program. That was meant to be a compliment, but they're my friends. I actually know a real housewife. Anyway. Happily. respiratory reserve volume. So at any given time, we have enough lung capacity to inspire above tidal volume. So that's inspiratory reserve volume. So it's there, so it's considered a reserve. We can inhale. We can force that rib cage open big, really big. And that volume should be in the neighborhood of about 3 liters. We can force more out than just normal passive exhalation by using the internal intercostals, accessory muscles, and that's going to be in the neighborhood of 1,200 mils or 1.2 liters expiratory reserve volume. And the residual volume is what's remaining after you forced everything out that you can force out. You can't get to that. And that just keeps everything open. Alveolar patency. So the word patent just means intact, open. A duct is patent if it's open. The sphere is patent if it maintains that shape. So those, all of those. And then we have capacities, which is a combination of those things. So the inspiratory capacity, the full amount that you can inspire, is going to be tidal volume plus that inspiratory reserve volume. So those two things added together, so that should be about 3.5 mils, 3.5 liters. TD plus IRV. You know, these are just things you sit with. It makes sense because you breathe. You can practice all of it. In fact, I hope you're practicing it constantly. That will not be true in all the sections we cover. Functional reserve capacity really then is that residual capacity that you can't touch, but then how much you can actually exhale forcibly. So that's that ERV plus RV, functional reserve capacity. Amount of air remaining in lungs after tidal expiration. So forced expiration plus just residual. Vital capacity is the total amount of exchangeable air. So tidal volume plus what you can inspire above that, plus what you can exhale beyond that. That's vital capacity. So vital capacity is like 4 liters.
Here's 46.
And that's going to be dependent on, you know, body size and all that. Men tend to have a little bit larger lungs and a little bit more exchange volume. Those are different, but it's relative to all two people. And so that's why if you're measuring these and following these, you say, where are they here? Where are we getting them? And those numbers are, what do you expect or predict? TLC is the sum of all of those total lung capacity. So those are useful volumes. And look, there's a summary of all of it. You should have a feel for those numbers, just generally, anyway, because of pulmonary function tests and so forth. You'll be getting these again, too. Somebody else is going to come in here and talk about these a lot. Reactive airways disease, you definitely do this a lot. Here's just a different picture of the whole thing. Well, I like that because it attaches it to the lung, and you can see there's some lung remaining, some air remaining. It's not just at the base of the lungs. Throughout, but that gives you that kind of picture of it. Now, just because air has moved in doesn't mean you can use that air. So there's water in your ducts that never, you don't see in the toilet or coming out of the faucet because there's just air, there's just water there. It's not necessarily, it's not, that's probably, whatever. Let's just move on. So anyway, you have two things, two ways, we call it dead space. Because you're not, it's there, but you can't use it as a respiratory exchange gas. And so there's anatomical dead space, which is just really meaning there's ductwork, there's air in that ductwork. It won't necessarily make it all the way down to the respiratory area. And so that's pretty small, like 150 mils. So that tubing's really little when you think about it. And then think about just tidal volume or how much air can actually be exchanged via the lungs. 4,600 milliliters. There's only that much in the conducting zone. So it's pretty efficient. It means that you're really getting air to where it needs to be. But there's also physiological dead space, which means there's some sort of thing going on that's decreasing the amount of air that's useful. And so that could be an alveolus that's not functioning well, a whole sac of them, a whole lobe. And you certainly see that when you need to talk about pneumonia, where how much of the lung is affected. So you'll look at x-rays and you say, this is segmental, it's consolidated, it's lobar, it's an entire lung, or it's both sides. That kind of how much is involved. So those will be, that's physiological dead space because you're not getting air exchange, even though there's air there. You can have just actually mucus being involved in the way. And that's going to just in effect how much ventilation can go across that membrane. So ventilation is air movement. Or there could be a problem from that other side that we haven't talked about, that cardiovascular side. So think of the alveoli being just surrounded by that mesh of capillaries. So from that side, what if we haven't gotten the blood to that area for gas exchange? We call that perfusion. So there's two angles that could be problematic. And is it a lung thing or is it a cardiovascular thing? Lung things are about ventilation. Cardiovascular things are about perfusion. But in either case, we could say, well, that's a dead space because there's air there that you're not using as a respiratory gas. And so that really goes to how much air is really functional, or how much of the lung is really functional. And that's really the more useful, you have to know all those terms, but the way you use them is in these pulmonary function tests, and it's more of a dynamics than what's really moving to tell us the story of how these lungs are working. Pulmonary function tests, measure of pulmonary function, dysfunction, efficacy, and medications. So a few dynamic kind of numbers. One is minute respiratory volume. Total volume moved in a minute. So that goes to respiratory rate and that ventilatory effort. And so tidal volume, that minute respiratory volume would be tidal volume, which is just normal quiet breathing, times breaths per minute. And a normal place for respiratory rate is about 12 per minute. And this is interesting because when you have heart rate can be quite variable. But for the most part, respiratory rate is less changeable, in a sense, amongst the population. So, you know, there will be variations, but they're not wildly so. You know, you can have normal heart rate from 60 to 100. Now, at either end, you're starting to wonder what's going on. But you don't see, like, 12 to 24 as a normal respiratory rate. Respiratory rate is a little more controlled. So anyway, that's pretty average. So the minute respiratory volume is how much air is a person moving. Now that starts to look like a lot. 6 liters in a minute. Now you see the great amount of air that you have to get in to keep this deal going without anything else going on. When you're moving around, you have to have a lot of air movement. Or then think about communicating during all this and coordinating breath with communication and how that's a whole other aspect that goes on. Certainly rate and depth increases with activity or decreases with pathology or increases with pathology. One of the least useful things you'll hear often. Here are some dynamic numbers from pulmonary function tests which you will cue in on. Forced vital capacity, FVC. It's a deep breath and a rapid forced exhalation. Now that number isn't very useful, but what we can do is compare how much then segmentally did you get out in that time. So look at this, forced expiratory volume, FEV. That is an interval, a measurement. An interval measurement. So look at this curve, time and volume. So an exhalation, a forced exhalation overall is in this 6 seconds-ish. We should be getting the majority of the air that moves in that time. It's not linear. It's not you exhale and then it just goes in a linear fashion. You exhale because of compliance, and most goes in the first bit. And then we segment, which makes sense, because when you just, well, in this case, you're forcing it out too. You're really compressing that air, and it should, that change, the difference in atmospheric pressure and intrapulmonary pressure should be really great the minute you create that, and the most should leave. As intrapulmonary pressure gets closer to equilibration with the exterior pressure, it slows down. The greater the gradient of pressures, the faster the movement along that gradient. Now, if that doesn't make any sense, what I just said, let it go. It doesn't matter. Because just look at the curve. When you exhale via just tidal or forced, the majority comes out earliest, which is great. It's just great, effective tissue. Everything's working well. So then you compare the whole amount that gets exhaled forcibly versus how much is exhaled in that first second. That is the FEV1, and this is the big ratio that you'll use a lot and most probably when looking at pulmonary function tests or guiding efficacy of treatment. So this really becomes numbers you see a lot. And so a normal ratio, so the forced vital capacity is around 4 liters. The majority, or that first second, you get rid of, you exhale 3 liters of it. So 80% of that whole capacity is exhaled in the first, forcibly in the first second. That's normal. So it's 80% ratio. Now, with lung dysfunction, with lung pathology, you see those numbers change. And that's where the pulmonary function test becomes useful. You'll learn a lot more about this pathophysiology quite pleasurably. And I'm only going to mention it here a little bit. But you'll see there are restrictive patterns and there are obstructive patterns. An obstructive pattern means that something is in the way of that airway. That could be whatever, a tumor, a cyst, a tubercle, mucus, inflammation, bacterial accumulation, anything like that will obstruct. Or you could have some sort of tissue fibrosis, which will restrict the ability of this tissue to expand. And those become things like fibrotic things like systemic lupus erythematosus, or autoimmunities and things like that that create tissue issues, not really lung obstruction. So you can have lung obstructive versus restrictive, and you treat them differently. And so these pulmonary function tests can help you tease out which one it is, or so they say. Here's just a couple of examples. And overall, from this physiology standpoint, I want you to see that. Look, normal is up there in red, a normal lung, a great, nice, big volume that you can exhale, and you exhale the majority of it quite quickly. So if there's a lung disease, you would expect that volume to be decreased. It is. You would expect the amount that you can get out to be decreased. It is. For both obstructive and restrictive cases. But you'll see some differences in that rate based on the different things. An obstructive disease, the FEV1 over FVC ratio will be below expected. And with a restrictive disease, it can be above expected. And I'm not going to talk about the pathophysiology of all that. You'll look at it, you'll learn it. However, the fact is so often there can be a mixture. And either way, you see, I think the most important thing to kind of keep in mind when you're learning all this stuff and you're trying to remember which is which and all that, always remember what's normal. And everything else goes from there. And so normal is a nice, big, forced vital capacity that you exhale quickly, the majority of. And then everything else is a dysfunction. And then you can kind of deduce and tease out which is which. So anyway, that's just a little example about that. But that's the dynamics that are useful in pulmonary function testing. So I said there was this minute respiratory volume, how much you just breathe in a minute via tidal volume. That's a number. A little better number for effective ventilation is this alveolar ventilation rate. It's one thing just to get air in, but are you getting the air to the alveolus, which is where stuff is really going to happen? Pulmonary gas exchange is going to happen. And so you just subtract dead space from minute respiratory volume, basically, to get alveolar ventilation rate. So it's just another number, AVR. So you're taking out that 150 mils for physiological, or for anatomic dead space, 4.2 liters. And yet another definition. And then just, you know, I can't say this without mentioning that there are a lot of reasons we move air that aren't just inhalation and exhalation, and you've done all of these, and a lot of you have done all of these today. I would say all of you have done all of these today. A corf. Are you corfing? You're starting to corf now. That's a really bad sign. A cough, forced expulsion of air from the lower respiratory tract, so irritants and whatever will cause you to cough. Sneezing is forced expiration from the upper airway. Hiccuping, you hate them so bad. Diaphragm spasms, laughing, crying are really the same. Yeah. Emotional induction and release of and then a yawn. Yawns are so interesting, and they're so contagious too. And do you have a time of the day that you yawn until you're just worn out? But for me, yawning is, it just makes you yawn. I'll start to yawn around, just kind of pre-dinner, late afternoon, and I'll be like, I'm so tired from yawning. You know, it's just, you know, the struggle is so real. Anyway, yawns are very interesting. Okay, properties of gases. Dalton's Law. So, we breathe, you have your lungs, you have your conduction, you have your ventilation, you have your inhalation, you have your exhalation. So, what's the point of all of that is to get gas to go from the air across the lung tissue into the blood, delivering oxygen, and to get rid of carbon dioxide that came from glucose and back out into the atmosphere. That's the whole point. And so now we need to look at gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide, and the property of gases, and how do we make that happen? Are you just bubbling all the time, gases through your blood? No. And so there is a lot of trick to getting a gas moved, to getting gas moved through your cardiovascular system. And so we must look at that happily. Properties of gases, Dalton's Law, total pressure exerted by a mixture of gases is the sum of the pressures of each gas. That's a law of partial pressures. So if in this space, whatever the pressure is it added up from all the various different kinds of gases that are in it? That's all that means. So in atmosphere, the pressure is 760 millibars, sea level 760. Then here are the common gases that are in our atmosphere, nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide and water. And so the majority of gas is nitrogen, almost 80%, and oxygen 20, CO2 really low, and then some water. And then there's the partial, so the pressure of each of those, the partial pressure of each of those adds up to the total pressure in the atmosphere. That's what Dalton's Law means. We'll look at Henry's Law. Then, because it's not just about the pressure of gas in the atmosphere, we have two different phases. We're getting air in a gaseous form. We're getting gases in a gaseous form into the alveolus. But then we're moving into an aqueous solution, and we're moving gases from air to liquid. And so we have to look at the properties of gases in both of those media. Henry's law, the solubility of a gas in a liquid, is directly proportional to the pressure of that gas in the phase just above it. Which is to say, which simply put is, if here's a pressure, and then here's some fluid, and how soluble or how much that gas will dissolve into that fluid has to do with the pressure of the gas in the air above that fluid. And so if there's a really high pressure here, you're going to force or solubilize more of that gas into the liquid. And so gases have their own natural solubility in water. CO2 is very soluble in water. Oxygen is a 20th of that. So isn't that a lovely way we've created, or someone created, that we are dependent upon a gas that is insoluble practically in fluid, but we have to get it into fluid. So we have to have a lot of things to help with that. You can think of one immediately. What is something that the body does to help enhance the solubility of oxygen? Okay, all right, let's look at it this way. You already know all this stuff. We're just gonna put together some concepts. So, what's in blood? Hemoglobin, see? So hemoglobin is that thing that's gonna carry oxygen in the blood. See, you already know all of this. It's just about, always use your common sense and then add to it, because your common sense is already there. You didn't have to memorize that, you already knew that. So you know you have a lot of hemoglobin in blood, in red blood cells. Blood is filled with red blood cells. There's a few white blood cells, but you know it's mostly red blood cells and water and proteins. So what's inside those red blood cells? Almost nothing but hemoglobin. What does hemoglobin do? Yes, it carries oxygen. And so oxygen is so insoluble. You're what?
I don't really
want to
talk about it anymore.
Oh, you just had your heme on exam. Like, the anemias, they're so hard. Oh, they're hard. They just are. I'm sorry. Okay, well, see, you already know that. Let's use it in a friendlier way. So you have hemoglobin because it has such a high affinity for oxygen that it helps overcome this insolubility factor. Because you can't really increase the partial pressure of oxygen in the lungs. You can't change Henry's law in the atmosphere. What you can do is try to make oxygen more tasty. And you do that by hemoglobin. Aw, now you like hemoglobin again. I'm just proud of you for not blatantly flipping me off. I know it's there on the inside. Maybe. Did you ever do that to your parents? Walk around the corners and flip them off?
Maybe. It's the Ross thing.
Oh, the Ross thing. Yeah. Yeah. And then unagi. Okay, so look, a hyperbaric chamber makes use of Henry's law by putting someone in to increase atmospheric pressure. That's one of the ways you can use Henry's law to increase the atmospheric pressure, which would really help increase the solubility of oxygen into tissue. And it's a way of, you can't really necessarily super quickly create more hemoglobin, but by golly, you can increase pressure and make use of Henry's law. Not commonly used in every hospital, but like, for example, Baptist has hyperbaric chambers, and it's really used mainly for wound healing for burn victims. But you'll see that people with carbon monoxide poisoning, if that's available in that hospital setting. Composition of alveolar gas. Okay, so this is interesting. Only to me. So look, this is the same numbers, air, those same numbers, same percentages from before. That's what's in air. Then look what's in alveolar gas. We would expect it to be a little different. Okay, so nitrogen is really about the same because we're not using nitrogen gas. So there's it just is the same inside as outside. But look at oxygen. So 20% in air, but only 13% in the alveolar gas. And that's because the diffusion of oxygen across that respiratory membrane and onto... Don't you give me... Oh, girl! Your eyes just burned my skin off. I felt that, like, emotionally. Oxygen is so great that that oxygen has moved out of the alveolus, and so the oxygen pressure is lower in the alveolus just based on function. This is not anything you wouldn't figure out. So carbon dioxide pretty low in the atmosphere, but pretty high in the alveolus because you burned glucose and eliminated it as carbon dioxide via the Krebs cycle. Oh, give it to me. Oh, come at me, bro. And so it's very high in the alveolus, so that makes sense. So this is just to set up the fact that, yeah, stuff's going on, and you're doing some things in the lungs, and you, alveolar air is different than air. Start to get a little frightened. Now I know Dr. Britton's going to come in, so I'll open these so he... People are so nice and they won't walk in, and I'm not, I'll just bust in. But it's pretty nice. Diffusing capacity of the lung is directly proportional to the surface area. So we're trying to get gases across the surface area. We've increased the surface area a whole lot by these spherical alveoli, a whole bunch of them. And so that will help, that helps the capacity to diffuse, increase surface area. So the area of the, and so here's a picture. An equation, I mean. And so the diffusing capacity is directly related to the surface area for diffusion and inversely related to the thickness of that tissue. That makes sense. You diffuse better if the membrane is really nice and thin and there's a great surface area. That's all that means. But you'll see DLCO. Quite often through sort of the physiology of pulmonics, I guess. And it refers to the diffusing capacity of the lung to carbon dioxide because it's very easily measured. That DLCO, which you'll continue to see, is a measure of how well oxygen and carbon dioxide are transferred or diffused. Diffusing capacity is a measure of how much you can transfer these gases. CO2 is a test gas, so that's why you see DLCO. And if you, it gets reduced, this makes complete total sense. DLCO, or diffusing capacity for gas exchange, is decreased if the surface area is reduced, or if that membrane gets thicker. You reduce the surface area in obstructive diseases because there's a block. You increase the thickness of that membrane in restrictive diseases where you have some sort of, especially kind of, say like a cartilaginous disease, fibrosis. So disease decreases diffusing capacity. And let's see what that next thing is. We'll stop there.
Before you get just even angrier.
I know you do have another lecture. I will be back to finish these slides in the morning at 10. I guess you have a lecture at 8 probably. Mm-hmm. And so these days are long and they're full, and you have to take care of yourself. So I would encourage incentive spirometry. Keep your lung health. I'm not even kidding. Keep your lung health good. You don't need to risk illness. Oh shoot, too late for you. allergy season in Oklahoma, if you're not used to Oklahoma, everything is covered with dust and an allergen, and it will only get worse. So be aware of that. You need to hydrate to thin your mucus. And if you know you're a person to get that, an over-the-counter, non-drowsy antihistamine is not a bad idea to keep on hand so that you're ready for that. Rest, hydrate, protein, and I'll see you in the morning.
Okay, bye.
And Dr. Britton will be in a minute.
Well, because you were like, what was the last thing? And I saw that you wrote this, and I was just like, it's just like, it's right there.
Yep. It's that time of the day.
Yeah. I was like, I didn't write it down. Like, I didn't need to for some reason. And I was like, oh, yeah.
I don't read
Yeah.
Sometimes I see something, and I'm like, oh, I don't like that.